Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
We're back for our post-All-Star edition of Fireside Chat, and as always, I'm Dan alongside Matt. Matt, what'd you think of the All-Star game this week?
I thought it was one of the best All-Star games that the NHL's ever seen, and it was the highest rated ever.
You and I talked last week about the 3-on-3 format, and we weren't sure what to make of it, but I don't know. I was going in skeptical, and I actually enjoyed the game.
Same here. I think that having short benches with having each of the four divisions represented allowed each team to overly showcase their star players, and the tournament format worked.
Yeah, I thought the tournament was interesting. I'm hearing fans who've said they want to go 3-on-3 forever after this, and I don't think that's by any means what you're going to do, but I liked sort of the pond hockey feel. The 3-on-3, it seemed more of a fun game than it did, you know, a really competitive 5-on-5 NHL game. And I think maybe that's what changed some of the flow and the feel of the game to me. It's like if you ever went to the Flames Veterans 3-on-3 pond hockey here in Calgary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, having 3-on-3 for every game would be a little ridiculous because teams, if you give any coach enough time, they'll figure ways of clogging up the game and making it really boring. So, and even in the third period of the All-Star game, you could start to see all the players starting to be a little sluggish in their skating. And if you had that for the full 60 minutes, I think teams would all be dying by the end of it.
Yeah, I think if you were going to go 3-on-3, you'd have to make the ice a lot smaller, too.
Mm-hmm. And you'd basically be changing it into a basketball type of game. And yeah, that's not hockey at that point.
So the Flames All-Stars were on the Pacific Division team, and the Pacific Division team ended up winning the tournament. I thought it was a great night for John Scott. He did a lot more than I expected the guy to. What did you think of what we saw of Gaudreau and Monahan? Or sorry, Gaudreau and Giordano.
I thought Gaudreau was probably going, if it wasn't for John Scott and his whole story, I think Gaudreau would have won the All-Star MVP. He could have easily had 5 or 6 points. He finished the night with a goal and 2 assists. And I think he hit the post 2 or 3 times. So overall, I think he was the best player in the game. And I thought that the story surrounding John Scott made the weekend.
Yeah, he looked better than I thought he did. It really became sort of the inspirational story. And I think it gave a storyline to the All-Star game that we haven't seen in years. And maybe that's why the game seemed more fun and laid back. But I don't know, it just seemed like there was that storyline this time that we haven't seen.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this was something that the NHL screwed up. I mean, you know, we saw Scott get in and then they forced the trade, or so it said, and he got sent to the AHL. But to me, it all worked out perfectly in the end.
Yeah, it almost seemed movie-esque in how the whole situation played out.
Well, I'm told that there's actually been some Hollywood studios approaching John Scott about his story.
And that would be good. When you're a fourth line type player, you're not going to be raking in the dollars like Johnny Gaudreau. So that things like that and advertisements and other endorsements will do nothing but help him after his post career life.
They'll probably change the character's name in the movie to Scott John.
Yeah, got to change things up a bit.
But, yeah, no, I thought it was fun. I think there's a lot of takeaways for the league from this year. I definitely agree with you that it was an interesting year. Everybody seemed to be having a lot of fun. I think as fans, more people I know watched it this year than in the past. But to me, there's still a couple things that need to change, and one of them is changing the selection criteria of the All-Star game. We talked a bit about this last week. I don't know about you. I'll share some of my thoughts. I think that the fan voting thing, as much as it's a good idea in principle, we saw with the John Scott thing, it can be abused. And I think there's a difference between an All-Star game and a fan favorites game. If you want this to be the All-Star game, I think you need to put some sort of All-Star criteria on it. Make a guy an All-Star. whether that means having, you know, some sort of criteria. I could see the league saying, okay, this is what it takes to be an all-star. So many goals or points or plus minus or whatever it is. Anyone who hits that is automatically put on the team, and then we'll vote the rest in. Or I've also heard it pitched, the idea, and I'm quite fond of this one as well, I think more so, is that each team would submit, say, three names. It could be three forwards, three defensemen, you know, two defense and a goalie, whatever you want to do, and the fans can only vote those three guys into the team, and I think that makes sense. What do you think for selection criteria? Do you think it needs to be changed?
Yes, and I actually think what they should do is just have, like, the NHL just pick most of the team, but have each of the four teams have, like, what used to be the commissioner's pick, where you have a certain group of players that have been, like, a list of decent players that have never actually made the All-Star team but are quality players. So I'm just trying to think of, like, say, like, a guy like Justin Williams, who's been a very good player, not necessarily an All-Star, getting up in years in his career. Somebody like that, where it, a quality player, but somebody that's never actually been to an All-Star game. I think something like that might...
So you're kind of thinking that the league picks the All-Stars, and then there's, like, one fan vote for per team.
Per division. So, like...
Per division, okay.
Each team will have, like,
well, a favorite... Well, that's kind of what I mean, yeah, each All-Star team.
Like, a favorite guy that... Just, like, the under... appreciated good player that just has never actually made the All-Star game, but a quality player, not some, like, a fourth line guy. And you'd have a list of those players as well.
And who do you think would put together that list? The league, or
the league?
Okay.
Or the teams, they could submit a guy, but I think the league would make it would be a little easier.
That's interesting. So, yeah, that really kind of gives you... And even in that scenario, I'd be okay if the league didn't even submit it, but it was a fan vote of truly anyone.
Yeah.
I think that would be another way to do it. But I think that the whole fan voting thing, if they want to keep doing the entire team voted by fans, I think you change it from the All-Star game to the fan favorite game.
Exactly. And I also think that... Each team should have a representative, and I, like, if you look at Arizona, they didn't have, like, even though John Scott technically was, they still, like, he wasn't on their team, so it's one of those fun things that I think that the NHL should, that's why I think the NHL should pick the majority of the team and allow... Continue to have the fan interaction with the secondary thing.
Yeah, I can see that. And I think, I don't know, if you look at the NHL compared to other leagues, there's a lot less, I would say, social media use in the NHL. You don't see as many big, I mean, everyone has an account, but you don't see the kind of feuds and rivalries in the NHL you do in other leagues. And I think that getting their players more involved with that, with each other, could lead to some interesting sort of all-star rivalries and teams and stuff too, getting people tweeting each other and, you know, kind of trash talking each other for the game. And I think that could, or even pleading with fans across the league, hey, vote me in, that sort of thing. I think that could really help with some of the fan interest in that one or two positions they could pick as well.
Mm-hmm.
I would also be open to sort of what you're saying of the fans picking somebody. I think it would also be interesting to have a rookie put on every team, and maybe, you know, make that either a position the fans vote best rookie, or, you know, just bring in the best rookie from each division, so there's automatically a rookie put on every team.
Yeah, I think that I would even say that that should be an NHL mandated pick as well, sort of like the Calder candidates.
Yeah, that could work.
So, like, Larkin, Eichel, McDavid, if he was healthy, and, say, Panarin would have been the four likely candidates from this year.
Yeah, and they used to have the Young Stars game where you could showcase all those guys, and they don't really have that anymore. So I would love to see, yeah, every team has to have at least one rookie. I mean, if there's a rookie that's great, bring him in, put them into, you know, one of the regular spots. But yeah, I'd like to force a rookie into every team.
I think each between like 7 or 8 teams, there's got to be one guy that's halfway decent. Like it might not be a star caliber prospect, but even somebody that's just okay, any division should have one of those guys.
And then if you remember in the past, and even this year, fans were voting for captains. When they did the pick'ems, the fans voted the captain. This year, the fans voted the captains. Do you think the fans should still continue to vote for their captain?
I think if they did my suggestion was, I think the fan vote would be for those guys, and those guys would be the captains. So the underappreciated guys would be the captains.
Interesting. Okay. See, to me, I don't know, the captain, it should be a respect thing, I think. And to me, I would like to see the players on the teams nominate their own captain.
Yeah, that could work as well. To me, it doesn't matter that much outside observer. You can pick anybody. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, the
me.
Captain role is really a figurehead at the All-Star game. But
it's who gets to stand with Bettman and pose with the check afterwards.
I like the idea this year of giving the $1 million to the winning team. I think that maybe changed the stakes a little bit. Would you like to see the NHL?
Yeah, you could definitely see the players were playing a lot more focused on the actual game itself, especially in the third period. Sutter's team shut it down. So
yeah, I thought that was kind of a neat way of doing it, is giving out that money and putting some incentive on the weekend.
It was a lot more interesting.
3-on-3, would you want the league to try that again, or do you think there's a better format?
I think for the All-Star game, the 3-on-3 was perfect, and I would keep that for as long as it remains relevant.
I think I said this last week. I'm not convinced we still need the game. I think if they're going to do the game itself, 3-on-3 is the way to go. I liked what we saw this year. I was pleasantly surprised by what we saw. But I could see moving All-Star Weekend into being more of a skills competition weekend. Ideally, what I think would be cool is for every one of the 30 teams to do their own skills comp. Do you remember the Flames used to do one? It was like a Sunday morning. And they had all the Flames players run through all the same skills comp games. I think it'd be neat to have all 30 teams do that, and then you take the best of those guys and bring them to one event so we could really find out who is the fastest skater, who is the hardest shot.
Yeah, that could work.
So you know,
I can't argue with you on that. So
let's say it's, you know, maybe the top 10 from each event. So there'd be 30, you know, 30 guys. Each team would have one winner, and then the league would take the top 10, bring them together, and face them off. I think that's easier on the body because you're not playing a whole hockey game.
Yeah.
And the guys seemed to have a lot of fun during the skills comp.
Well, it was just like that one year when the Flames had Ed Ward going to the All-Star game because he had was one of the hardest shots.
I don't even remember that. Wow.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and that could...
That was something that the NHL used to do back in the late 90s.
And maybe that's the thing to do, is maybe they're two different events. Maybe the skills comp contains guys that aren't All-Stars, but those are just the guys that won the individual skills competitions.
Yeah.
And then the actual All-Star game is a different subset of players. I mean, some of them are obviously going to overlap, but a guy like an Ed Ward, who's just a hard shot, wouldn't play in the actual All-Star game. But, you know, maybe you give some prize money to the winner of each event.
Could be. I can't argue, so... As long as the NHL keeps trying new things, I don't mind. Because you have to see what works and modify things that don't. And just always try to make improvements to draw fan interest. Because that's, at the end of the day, that's what it's all about, is showing off the best of the NHL to fans that don't necessarily know anything about it.
And you and I were talking before we came on the air, but I think this is one of my favorite All-Star games that I can remember. And we were talking about how as kids we used to like the All-Star game. And I was saying to you, I think that there's a difference when you're a kid versus when you're an adult. I know with me anyways, when I was a kid, watching the All-Star game, it was like playing Nintendo or, you know, Sega. It's like, oh, this is like the team that I wanted to build on my Genesis game. These are all the best guys in the league. And it was East versus West. And it felt as a kid, it's like, wow, it's the biggest names in the league. And as you get to be older, you realize, ah, they're not really putting in the effort. And, you know, the game's not that great of hockey and that sort of thing. And I think some of that magic I remember of the All-Star game as a kid came back this weekend for me.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly. And I think that the financial incentive was the difference, because last year's All-Star game was painful to watch. And it was like you could tell everybody was dogging it and they were just going through the motions. But this time, everybody seemed to be actually trying to compete properly.
Yeah, no, I definitely think that you've got that right about the financial incentive. I think the 3-on-3 probably helped too, though, because there's not as much. I mean, the game's not as physical.
No.
When you're playing 3-on-3, and I think some of that is just looking at the game and saying, okay, it's not going to be as physical a game. It's not going to be as hard on my body. So sure, I'll play a bit harder. Why not? I have nothing to lose. You know, you're not getting rammed into the boards and that sort of thing. And honestly, most of the play in that game was right in the middle of the ice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you didn't see, other than John Scott laying out his good friend Patrick Kane, I there was no physical contact really between anybody throughout the game.
So. Yeah, I think this is a winning format, at least for now, and I don't want to see them experiment with something else. I'd like to see them just stay with this format for the foreseeable future. And
full credit to Nashville for being an absolutely perfect host for the weekend.
Yeah, Nashville's one of those cool cities that has its really unique vibe. I mean, you know, it's got the country music vibe and all that, and I think that it was probably partly, too, a destination players wanted to go. Because last year was what, Buffalo?
Well, I honestly don't recall.
Okay. Because, you know, like, I know people I know said, I want to go to Nashville to go to the All-Star game. Like, I think it's just the whole city has that really cool vibe to it. And that probably helped the feeling of the weekend as well. You know, guys bring their wives and their kids, and there's lots to do. Well, with the All-Star game out of the way, why don't we recap the other two games this week? It was a short week because of the All-Star game, and the Flames played two games, and they lost both of them by the same score. It was a 2-1 loss against the Dallas Stars and a 2-1 loss against the Nashville Predators. So let's go through these games. Let's start with the Dallas game. Flames got outshot 30-24 by Dallas. Overall thoughts of this one, Matt?
You can't start games like the Flames did. At one point, the shots were 19-4 for Dallas, and the Stars quickly struck in the early part of the second period with two quick ones. You just can't do that at the NHL level and expect to get any points at the end of the night. It doesn't matter who you're playing, and it was just a disappointing start to the game, and they tried in the third period to come back, but it was too late.
I wasn't sure what to expect from this game. I mean, we've had good success so far against the Stars this year. And after coming off the Hurricanes game where the Flames didn't show up to play, I was excited at the beginning. I thought the Flames started the game pretty quick. I thought the tempo of the game they started with was pretty quick. I thought that in the first period especially, they did a great job of defending against the Stars. They let that go late, but I thought in the first period they did a pretty good job defending. But in the second period, they just let the Stars back in the game, not just from a goal perspective, but their game changed and they let the Stars back into it, and that's what I think overpowered the Flames.
Yeah.
Backlund, I thought, though, played a really nice game. It's good to see him contributing again and becoming a real, you know, part of this team. I think we've seen Backlund, as we've talked about in the past, we've seen Backlund sort of be iffy over the last couple of years, and people have talked about training him, and he's, you know, just another player. And I think that, especially with Backlund playing with Bennett lately, we've really started to see him come around.
I can't argue with that. He's been a good secondary player for the Flames, and if he can continue, there's no reason why the Flames would be looking to move him at least for the foreseeable future. Like, it 4 or 5 years from now is a different thing, but he could be a viable second, third line, not necessarily a center. He might eventually have to be moved to the wing, depending on who the Flames draft this year and how a guy like Mark Jankowski plays. So we'll see.
Looking at my notes for the Stars game, I also noted here that I thought the Flames at the end of the second period came back quite well. The Stars got 2 goals, and I thought that for the last maybe 5 or 6 minutes there, they actually looked like they were playing with a man advantage.
Mm-hmm.
They were getting a lot of good shots, and we saw that early in the third with the Colborne goal. But once again, I think one of the big issues here was the failure to capitalize on the power play.
Yeah. After a stretch where the Flames were looking quite good on the man advantage, they've just vanished entirely. And they've been getting plenty of opportunities, but like in the Dallas game, they had 4 power plays where they didn't even register a shot.
And if you want to have a shot at the postseason, you can't be doing that.
No. That's where, like, even if you're not necessarily generating a lot of chances on the man advantage in terms of shots, you need to have possession in order to gain momentum. Like, even if you don't score, you can carry that through and have subsequent good shifts. But if the other team's getting the puck and shooting it out repeatedly and you're not even getting any zone time, that just halts any positivity.
Yeah, and you've got to get those shots. I mean, the Flames went 0 for 5 in the power play. Dallas went 0 for 2. I can see going 0 for 2, but you know, this isn't the first game, and I think it's yet another time when we weren't just bad on the power play, but we had the chance for the power play to turn this game around if we would have capitalized on it. And that's when I hate to see them being bad.
Well, even one goal, that's a tie game going into
exactly.
Overtime.
I mean, with 5 power play chances, you know, you can't score on any one of them. And like you said, can't even get a shot on most of them. That's bad news. I mean, that tells you this team is not to the caliber of being a postseason team like we'd like them to be.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Flames came back home and played against the Predators. And this was sort of a weird game. There's some weird stuff that happened here. We'll talk about it. But to me, when I look back at this game and I was at the Dome, the biggest thing I thought was Stajan had a terrible night. Stajan seemed like he was always giving the puck away.
Yeah, he was notably visible throughout the contest and not in a positive way.
Yeah, like...
like, third-pairing defenseman, if you're noticing Matt Stajan, that's usually not a good thing. And he was notably bad.
Yeah, like, I was noticing that the Flames had a lot of giveaways. The Flames had 17 giveaways in this game. And every time I seemed to look over, it was Stajan giving the puck away.
And sometimes you have games like that, where absolutely everything you do goes not your way. And unfortunately for him, that was the case. I don't expect him to have a bad game against Carolina on Wednesday. I think it's just a one-off.
I don't know if the guys were just ready for their break or what happened in this game, but it seemed like neither team seemed like they were playing at 100%. Both teams seemed, you know, like they were slower than usual. They weren't really playing their game. And the Flames especially seemed like they were asleep for a good portion of the game. They came back to life in the third, I thought.
Too casual.
Yeah, too casual and just seeming like they just wanted the break.
Mm-hmm.
Like they were already looking ahead to that break.
And it was very much the same story as the Dallas game, where Nashville got out to the early 2-0 lead and outshot, outchanced the Flames thoroughly, and Calgary didn't really have any response until the third period, and once again, too little, too late. They did hit the post 3 times, and Carter Hutton made a few good saves, especially in the last seconds of the game, but you can't put yourself in a situation where you're down. And last year, the Flames likely tie that game, but this year we're not getting the same puck luck. And losses just keep piling up.
And not just, you know, putting yourself in a situation where you're down, but putting yourself in a situation where you're trying to tie a game with 3 seconds left. I mean, that game went right down to the wire. There's a faceoff in their end, I think, with 2.4 seconds left. And, you can't be doing that because you're not going to win those games.
No. Flukes do happen, but counting on it is not a winning strategy.
Also, some weird penalties in this one. Nashville took a penalty for a faceoff violation, and James Neal took a penalty for closing his hand on the puck.
Yeah, Flames had 3 power plays in the first period, and Nashville did not commit a single infraction on a Flame.
No, it was weird. One was for faceoff violation, one was puck over the glass, and one was closing hand on the puck.
Bizarre.
I still don't even know that first penalty. What was the faceoff violation?
Yarncroc, he gloved the puck.
Oh, okay. There you go. So
he actually kind of fell down and his hand touched the puck. I don't think he purposefully swiped at it, but I'd have to see the replay again. But it was just one of those bang-bang plays, and his hand just happened to touch the puck, and that's not a thing that you're allowed to do anymore.
And again, the Flames go 0-4 on the power play, and Nashville went 1-for-4. But like you said, there's 3 penalties. There's 6 penalty minutes in the first period. None of our guys got, you know, touched for any of those. And that's when you want to be capitalizing. You know, if we can capitalize on a face-off violation and get a goal, you know, puck over the glass and a closing the hand, that's when you want to make the team pay for making those dumb mistakes.
And it's the same story. One goal on the power play in any of the 4 opportunities, and
we'd be
it's
back
going
in
to overtime.
Yeah.
But the special teams was not capitalizing on their chances. Nashville, they had power plays in the second period. On the third one, Shea Weber slaps one past Ramo. Game winner. Game over.
Yeah, if you look at the Flames penalties in that one, too, they really seemed like not only were they playing a casual game, but they were quite undisciplined this game.
Mm-hmm.
It was not a usual Flames game. It felt like these guys just, I don't know, weren't ready to play or were tired. I'm not sure what it was, but I was disappointed by their effort. I mean, we've seen games like the Carolina game where they didn't look like they even showed up. And for this game, it was better than the Carolina game, but I still felt like, come on, guys, where are you? Like, what are you doing? We're, you know, play, put some effort into this. And I think if the Flames would have just played at 100% effort, they would have won the game.
Mm-hmm.
Because Nashville, I don't think, was playing at 100% either.
No. Actually, for Nashville, I think that was more representative of their typical games against the Flames, because they usually don't play that well against Calgary, at least in recent times. And yet they were able to skate away with the victory, even though the Flames had won the last 4 games against them.
Yeah,
so it is what it is. The Flames have not had very much consistency, even from period to period, let alone game to game. And that's one of the reasons why the Flames are finding themselves significantly out of a playoff spot.
Yeah, if we look back at the record for January, we were 4 wins, 6 losses, and 1 overtime loss in January. That puts us 2nd from the bottom. We now sit at 45 points. Edmonton's at 43 points. And Nashville's sitting in the bottom wildcard spot at 56 points. But even Arizona, who's at 53, that is, what, 8 points down that we are. So 8 points doesn't seem like a lot, but when you look at the way this team is playing, 8 points is a big hurdle.
Yeah. And then if you look at ahead to tomorrow's schedule, Edmonton and Columbus play against each other, so one of those teams will tie us in the standings, and the Flames are quickly sliding to the bottom of the NHL standings overall. They're only 2 points ahead of Columbus, Edmonton, and Toronto for dead last.
Well, you know how you know you're sliding to the bottom is when you start seeing teams playing their backup goalies against you. Like, looking at the last week or so, we're starting to see, you know, like Carter Hutton playing and stuff like that.
Niemi.
You know you're at the bottom of the league when those backups are playing.
Eddie Lack.
Eddie Lack.
Yeah, well, it makes sense. And despite that, the other teams are walking away with victories, which doubly shows how poorly the Flames have been playing.
So, I don't know. You know, eight points should not be that much, but that's...
It's actually very difficult, especially with the having four teams ahead of you. It's virtually impossible to make up that ground in only 34 games.
Especially when it's
games.
As tight as it is this year.
It doesn't sound like a lot, but if you figure that, say, teams are going to win 6 out of 10 games in terms of getting 12 out of 20 points, that in order to make up ground, you have to be getting like 14, 15 points every 10-game segment the rest of the way just to make up the ground. And if a team has a very good stretch, like San Jose, I think they're 8-0-2 in their last 10 games, you're pretty much screwed. And the Flames, I really don't expect them to be making the playoffs this year.
Can you imagine if we didn't have the December that we did? We would be probably way below Edmonton.
Oh, if the Flames didn't have Johnny Gaudreau in overtime, because you got to figure the Flames have pretty much won every game that they've gone to, except for the one game against Arizona. If they, say they even had a 500 record in overtime, they'd be well behind Edmonton and Columbus. And if they didn't have that 7-game winning streak, yeah, it is what it is.
I mean, Edmonton's sitting at 43 points. I think it's conceivable that if we didn't have the December we did and we were playing at the same pace we have October, November, and now January, we could be at 40 or less points.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And, yeah, the Flames are looking like they're going to be firmly in the Austin Matthews sweepstakes, and especially with the month to come. 7 of the 13 games they play in February are against teams that are just outside the playoff spot, within 3 points of a playoff spot. So those teams are naturally going to be very hungry for the points. So you're likely going to be seeing teams that are playing their best hockey each night, and that makes it even that much more fun to attempt comebacks.
And not only hungry for the points, but probably... knowing that the Flames are an easy target.
Mm-hmm.
And that's probably going to be one of the things going into it is we're 2 points better than Edmonton right now. So
yeah
you're probably going to come in going, oh, we can get our points against these guys. And yeah, you're just going to want to roll all over them. So
yeah. And of the 13 games, only 2 are against teams that are outside the playoffs by more than 3 points. And that's Toronto and Columbus, who are 2 of the first 4 opponents in the month of February. So after that, it's all playoff teams and teams that are close by. So not so good.
Yeah.
It's looking more and more like the Flames are going to end up having to go into seller mode. And that's not a bad thing. It's just a disappointment for how this... things were coming into this season.
Yeah, I think that we came in overly optimistic this season. I think that if we look realistically, this is where we should be.
Yeah.
And even last year, I mean, you and I predicted last year the Flames were probably going to end up at the bottom.
Yeah, in the top 5. Like, I distinctly remember looking at who the top 5 players were and... oddly enough, hoping that the Flames were going to get Oliver Shillington, ended up doing so anyway, but that's a whole different thing. But yeah, it is what it is, and not much you can do, unfortunately.
No, but it's, as we've said, it's not as though this team is built for a Stanley Cup and they're failing. I mean, they're building as part of a rebuild. So this is par for the course.
Yes, and it's one of those situations that it's not like all of our good core players are playing terrible. you know, you've got Gaudreau, who's one of the top 10 scorers in the NHL. Sam Bennett is one of the top rookies in the NHL. TJ Brody's showing that he's one of the top defensemen in the league. Giordano is an all-star and one of the top scorers for defensemen. So
I think that even Hamilton we're seeing a great season out of.
Respectable. Him and Monahan, they've been just okay. I think that especially when Chris Russell and Dennis Wideman move on, I think you'll see Hamilton be more of that secondary player that you... Because Wideman and Russell have been getting a lot of power play time. I think that those minutes will go to Hamilton once those players move on. Overall, we'll see.
Yeah, no, I think you're right about, you know, we're not... It's not like we're having a bad season for everybody. And that's the good thing, is the guys that need to be having a good season, even guys like Hamilton, who... When I say that they're having a good or a great season, I guess I mean from a development perspective. You know, like he's not True. He's not an all-star. He didn't go this weekend to the all-star game, but we're seeing him develop. And if you look at where Hamilton was at the beginning of the year versus where he is now, that's what we need to be seeing from these guys. These years when we are lean and we're not making the playoffs, that's when we need to be, you know, having everybody developing. And if they're not, it's going to hurt us down the road.
Mm-hmm. And if you look ahead to the draft, the Flames, if they are picking in the top 7 or 8, they're going to get another player of a similar talent level as Sam Bennett, or possibly better, depending on exactly where the Flames select. So you'll be adding another core piece to the team moving forward at the draft, which that'll help for 2-3 seasons from now when the Flames are pushing up the standings and hoping to be a contender.
For sure. Before we leave this week and our thoughts on this week, we should probably talk about the Dennis Wideman incident. We won't get in for everybody into exactly what happened. You can go watch the footage yourself. But during the Nashville Predators game, Dennis Wideman got rocked in the corner, started skating back towards the Flames bench, and cross-checked linesman Don Henderson on his way back. And of course, you know, you're not allowed to touch an official. I was honestly surprised at the time there was no penalty, but now the league is talking about a indefinite suspension for Wideman. Matt, why don't you go first? What are your thoughts on the incident, and how long do you think Wideman should be out?
Well, I didn't actually see the collision when it happened, because I'm in the corner that's like beside the Flames bench, so I didn't visually see the actual hit, and they didn't show a replay in the building, so like everybody else, I was first saw it on replays and such. And it looked bad from the one angle. It looked less bad from the other. Overall, you can't hit an official, and it does look worse than it probably was. That said, I think that Wideman will probably get at least a 10-game suspension. He may get more depending on how much the referee association wants him to be made an example of.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing here is that he hit an official, and I think that you know, you can't do that. I mean, plain and simple, you can't touch an official. I think that every year we see somebody who somehow gets made an example of, and I think Dennis Wideman's going to be that guy this year simply because he did hit an official, and they think they have to send a message. I wouldn't be surprised if he's out for 10 games. I mean, we've got what, 30 left? So yeah, I mean, that's mm-hmm. a third of the time that's left. That's big, and I wouldn't be surprised if he is out for 10 games. I've heard 20 thrown around. I think 20 is a bit excessive.
It could be, and it's possible, and that would be harsh. But who knows? There hasn't really been a situation like this that I can recall in recent NHL history. So
yeah, I was going back and looking that up, and I couldn't find anything either. There's nobody that's just gone out and really hit an official. It's happened in the course of breaking up fights and stuff, but nothing I could find like this.
Like that, yeah, if you're in a fight situation where you're throwing punches and you accidentally hit the linesman, well, it's partially the linesman's fault for being there. But in the situation that the Wideman hit, I just can't think of any situation that was exactly like that. So it's kind of a new territory for the NHL.
And I think, I mean, I don't want to get into if it was deliberate or not. We haven't talked to Dennis. We don't know what was going through his head. But if you watch the footage, it looks deliberate. And I think if you don't make an example of Dennis Wideman, you're going to get into a slippery slope.
Mm-hmm.
Of, oh, well, I barely touched the official. And I think you might get guys who are angry. And, you know, maybe when they are being broken up by linesmen, they take a shot at the linesman thinking, well, it's okay because Dennis got off easily. And I think the Referees Association needs to...
Well, we've even seen that in recent times where players have actually pushed the linesman or the referee and they weren't penalized for it. And now Wideman hitting a linesman, I think that the slippery slope has already occurred when you've had players lightly push the referees and linesmen. I think that now the book is going to be thrown at Wideman, and I would hope that in the future, when situations occur, when a player does actually push a linesman or a referee, that they get a 10-game suspension like it calls for in the rule book.
Yeah, no, I agree. And as much as I don't like to see a Flames player made an example of, and I don't know if it was deliberate or not, I think based on what we saw, you have to suspend them.
Yeah. I can see both sides of the argument, but optics is a thing, and the NHL can't sweep this one under the rug. Like, it did make national news in the States. It's a black mark on the league, so they do have to follow through. It's unfortunate for Wideman. I don't think that he was intending on throwing that kind of a... Like, I think if he could redo it, I don't think he would have. But it is what it is, and just have to wait and see what exactly the punishment will be.
I think, and I heard that Don Henderson spent the night in hospital as well, and I think maybe the fact that he was in the hospital might even just warrant... It's like, you know, if blood is drawn, the penalty gets bigger. And I think that maybe just the fact that he was in the hospital, that might warrant it as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll see what happens, but I don't think if we lose Wideman for 10 games, it's going to be a big loss to the Flames right now. I don't know how you feel, but we've got more defensemen than we know what to do with. You know, England and or Smead will draw in, and they'll both be in the lineup. And if a trade is made, I think the Flames need to give Nacladol a shot. I don't think they're going to bring him up now and bench Smead or England because of it, but I could see if the suspension's still on after the deadline.
Say Wideman gets put out for 20 games, then, and the Flames say trade Russell at the deadline, then yeah, I could see Nacladol being brought up.
The only issue that I can see with this, and one thing I can see the Flames pushing for, is not to make the suspension go past the deadline, because I think that there might be a trade value for Wideman. It's going to be tough to move him if he's suspended.
Yeah, or if he is suspended past the deadline, like, only like a game or two beyond. So the Flames play 13 times between now and the deadline. So if you made it like a 15 game suspension, I think that'd be fine.
Yeah, even 10, right? You suspend them for most of the month, and as soon as that suspension's over, you can move them. But if they suspend them for 20, I think that's unfair to the Flames, because I think that he might have the most value he's going to get this year.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll see what happens. When is the Wideman trial or hearing?
Tomorrow.
Tuesday?
Yeah.
Okay. A lot's going on Tuesday. Wideman's hearing and the Leafs unveil their new logo.
Yeah.
Be curious to see what they unveil. I think it's probably going to be a similar Maple Leaf to what they have, but without Toronto Maple Leafs written in it.
We'll see.
And speaking of new logos, the Stockton Heat, our AHL affiliate, unveiled their new third jersey, and it is pretty much the Calgary Flames jersey template in black. So for anyone that wants to go look at it, you can find some pictures online, but it's essentially the white jersey template in with black on it. It's got the same piping, the same stripes, same everything. The one thing I do like, though, is on the Stockton logo. I mean, we've both been critical of the Stockton logo. They took the goofy red and black circle off it, and it's just the S, and I think it makes it look better. It's a white S, but not great. What are your thoughts on the new jersey, Matt?
Especially in game action, the whole setup looked significantly better than either the white or the red jerseys that they've been using. I'm still not a fan of the piping system that our jersey and Stockton's has.
Yeah, but if you're going to emulate the template, you're going to have the piping.
Yeah. Overall, it's a good jersey. Looked nice on the ice. It wouldn't necessarily look bad as a Flames jersey, although if they are going to go with that kind of a style, I'd rather the Flames use the template of the third jersey instead. But we'll see. It was a decent look, and I think that the Heat will benefit, especially from jersey sales, because I know some people on Calgary Puck were expressing interest in purchasing it, so overall, not bad.
You and I were looking at it, and I mean, I don't know if they still use the same ones, but the numbers that are being used are exactly the same as the old horse jersey. You and I were looking and doing some comparison. As far as we can tell, it's the exact same font as the 04 jersey, and the exact same, as far as name font and number font goes, it's all white, so it's not like the home jerseys now where we have the black and the red. It's like the horse jerseys. It's, you know, white lettering with a red border and then white numbers with a yellow and red border. And to me, it looks identical as far as letters and numbers go to the 04 jerseys. Or not 04, but that era. Like mm-hmm. The horse jerseys from that era. And actually, still the 04 jerseys. But yeah, the black ones we wore before that. The Heat website says it's the standard Flames font. But I don't know. It seems like the font has changed to me. Maybe not. Maybe I'm just thinking of the terrible number font on the third jersey.
Yeah.
I do, though, if the Flames were to take on this jersey, the Calgary Flames, I would like to see them bring back the white C. I think there's enough black and red in this jersey. And I think having the red, the black on red already, I think just looking at the interesting white S on here, I think that bringing back the white flaming C from the 90s could be an interesting touch if they were to bring this to Calgary.
Yeah. Well, I think that the Flames are likely going to have a new uniform set up next year when they switch over to Adidas. So whether they have a third jersey component to that or not is still to be determined. But if they do in the future, I think that would be a good idea. What you suggested.
Yeah, I don't think that the Flames have had as much takeoff as they hoped to as far as fan appreciation of the current third jersey. If you think about the jerseys they've had, I mean, they had the Black Horse one. That didn't get a lot of fan appreciation. Then they dropped the black, and they went with just in 06, 07, they went with just the red and the white. When the Edge jerseys came in, they had just the red and the white. Then they added in the retro, which a lot of people really liked, but it was still that red jersey. And I think now with the third jersey, I mean, we've talked about our thoughts on the third jersey. I think it's all mixed up. They're saying it's supposed to be more retro looking, but I don't know. It's, to me, it's got really modern numbers and a retro looking front, and it seems like they don't know who they want to be or what they want it to portray. But yeah. I could see the new jerseys having a similar striping pattern to the third jersey for the home and the away.
Yeah, I think that the third jersey, the striping pattern, and like even the shoulders, it looks good, except for the yoke thing.
I don't like that they have the diamond of the black. Yeah.
Yeah, if they straightened that out, maybe even rounded the shoulders, so the black continues all the way around.
And that's a bit of a throwback to our white jerseys from the 80s as well.
Yeah, so if you make those little minor alterations, put the flaming C on the middle instead of the flame Calgary thing.
And put our standard numbers on there. Get rid of the stupid third jersey numbers.
Yeah, and keep the shoulder patches. I think that would be a perfect red jersey. Make a white version of it, making the shoulders red instead of black. Good to go.
I don't know about you. I want them to retire the stupid Calgary script that they have on the third jersey. To me, our logo should just be the Flames.
They've tried that, like, the text type thing before. Like, in the 90s, they had the Flames and the block letters on the helmet. I think it looks cheesy myself.
Well, we still have Flames on our helmet. Every team has their name on their helmet.
Yeah. I don't know. It looks cheesy to me, and it's good to try new things, but that, I think, didn't work too well, and move on.
Yeah, and, you know, it's interesting, because if you look back at the Flames jerseys, I mean, in the 90s, you know, 98, when, and even before that, after the lockout, right in, from 95, when they had the pedestal jerseys, and even before that, it was the white C on the red, and it's 95 when we unveiled the black, and it wasn't until, geez, it wasn't until 2003 that we brought in the black flaming sea on the red background. But I like the idea of having a black jersey. I don't want it like they did in 2000 to 2003, where it becomes our primary jersey. That's when they had the white and the horse jersey. But I like the idea of a black for a third jersey. I like it better than the current third jersey. And I'd be okay if they want to do a red, a white, and a black with the new uniforms.
Same here. I think that, like, if they altered that, the current third jersey, like we were discussing, I think that might be the sharpest looking set of jerseys that the Flames have had. But we'll see. It depends on what their thoughts are, like if they're going to bring the flags with the new jerseys or any of that.
The one thing that I don't like about the Stockton jerseys, they mess up the pants striping. I think I'm the only one that cares. But the pants striping is designed to match the stripes in the home jersey. It sort of matches the stripes in the away jersey, but the middle part of where the black is on the red jersey is red on the new one, and it doesn't match the pants striping. Maybe I'm the only one that cares.
I think if they made the current third the home and away jerseys, then I think they would change the pants out.
Well, you have to. I mean, you have to go
that way. It makes sense.
Solid black pants, or I'm actually one of the few people who like their 90s pedestal pants.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't know if you remember them, but they had the big red stripe and then the little bit of yellow and white underneath it. And I always thought those were cool pants. So I think there's a lot you can do. I think a lot of teams don't do anything with their pants. I mean, the Flames just wear black pants during, you know, the early part of the 2000s. But, yeah, I think that there's more they could do with the pants, but you've got to change them out. I mean, even when they wore the retro jerseys, they wore red pants with the, you know, the classic striping on them. So, I don't know. I could see them going with – I could also see them dropping the black and going more with a retro color scheme with a new jersey look.
Yeah. Lots of different options available to them.
Yeah.
We'll see.
I think the thing I've noticed here, though, when someone wears a third jersey, whether it's the, you know, the current third jersey or the – not so much the Heritage Classic, but it's tough to know it's a third jersey because it's the same color. And I know it's great for the sea of red, and I like that aspect that everyone's wearing red. But you don't stand out as wearing the third jersey, and I think that's where a black jersey, it stands out a little bit more. So we'll see what they do. I could see them go more retro, but yeah, there's been no official announcement that Adidas is changing the jerseys. We're just speculating, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm just under the assumption because... Yeah, that's what happened when Reebok took over. Like, there wasn't really a huge build-up until they announced that, you know, everybody's going to be changing. So, we'll see.
Yeah, and I think there's some teams like, you know, Arizona that just changed and probably wouldn't change again, but I think it might be time for Calgary to make a change.
Well, it's been 9 years, so...
Yeah,
we're into a completely new era of the Flames and from the Iginla era.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, too. It's a new era. As we come out of the rebuild, it might be good to have a bit of a different look.
And realistically, when the Flames did change their look in 04 to have the red jersey, they went to the Stanley Cup Finals. So maybe switching things up might inspire them to propel themselves forward. Who knows?
It's interesting you mentioned the Iginla era, because if I look at the Flames jerseys from the past, you really do have, I think more than a lot of teams, you really do have eras. You know, we have the 80s era, sort of the McDonald era.
Classic. The Cup era.
Yeah, and then we have the mid-90s, the 95 through 2000 with the pedestal jersey, which I still look at as the Theo Fleury era.
Yes, same here.
When I think of the Flames in that uniform, I think of Theo Fleury.
Mm-hmm.
And then the 2000s, when the Flames debuted what ended up being their, I think, one of their most popular jerseys, the 2004 style, but that's when they had the black one and the white alternative in 2000. That was really the Jerome Iginla era. And that lasted all the way through, I think,
0506.
Yeah, 0506. Yeah, you're right. And that really was the year after the Cup and after the lockout. And then we got the RBK era. Iggy was still here, but the team was in transition. And I think we might look back at the RBK era as sort of a transitional period. And whatever comes next is the, I don't know, the Goudreau era?
Yeah.
But it's interesting just looking at these that, yeah, it is very...
regimentedly, segmented into blocks of time for each one.
Exactly. And you look at other teams who've changed their jerseys so much or not very much, and you really don't get that. So I think that's kind of cool that we've got those segments. I guess we should probably move on to talking about Stockton. Talked a little bit about them last week. They're doing well. Five wins in a row, two more wins this past week, and they're 9-2-1 in the last 12 since the 31st of December.
Well, it's interesting that now that they're being successful, we actually have things that are actually relevant to talk about with them instead of, oh, they lost again. So it's good to see.
They had their All-Star game today, Monday, and their skills comp yesterday. Derek Grant won the fastest skater at the AHL All-Star game skills comp. No surprise. He seems like he's probably, you know, too good for the AHL at this point.
Yeah, well, he scored twice in his last game and is now one goal out of first place overall in the league. So I think he's got 21 goals in 29 games this season. So he's been pretty dangerous down there.
And he's on a one-year deal, I believe, with the Flames.
Yes. I would expect if the Flames do begin to start selling off players as we get closer to the deadline, that Grant will be brought up.
Will be recalled.
Yeah.
And he's an RFA, so he's not going to walk away. And I imagine the Flames will have no problem bringing him back next year.
Yeah.
And I mean, he's making $700,000 this year.
Yeah, and with him being 6'3", 200 pounds, that would help bring some size to the Flames organization if they do decide to bring him up and try him out for the last month and a half.
For sure. You also mentioned that we're seeing a really nice line combination down in Stockton of Emile Poirier, Morgan Klimchuk, and Derek Grant. You think they're becoming a dangerous combo. Tell us about those three guys.
In the last game, it was a 4-2 game against Edmonton's farm team. And easily all three of Poirier, Klimchuk, and Grant could have had a hat trick in that game. It seemed like they started to get some chemistry with each other, and Klimchuk over the last handful of games, he's starting to be utilized more and relied upon as both a good offensive and a good defensive player. And now all three are starting to play, especially the two prospects, they're starting to play more like what we've come to expect from them and are really starting to come into their own. So it's good to see that the leadership from Grant along with the two kids seems to be combining to wreak havoc on the opposition.
That is. Yeah, it's good to see this team kind of rebounding and these prospects playing really good, because when your NHL team's not doing well, it's generally because you're in a rebuild, and that's when you need to be seeing those you know, young players in the AHL really upping their game and showing that they're ready to make the jump.
Yeah, and the Flames do have the luxury of having about six or seven players that could slot in the NHL lineup if they do go into full seller mode, and that's not including guys like Poirier and Klimchuk, so it allows some flexibility moving forward. And Stockton has closed within a few points of a playoff spot and are on their way up, so
it's good to hear.
Hopefully they can keep it up. They're playing a lot more over the next couple of weeks than they have, so hopefully with Kevin Poulin playing really well and Yanni Ordio starting to pick up his game a bit, the team seems to be putting all the pieces together to go on a run in the last couple months.
We talked about Ordio and Poulin last week and how the team seemed to be playing better for one and not the other. But if you look, Ordio's won five of his last six starts, and has a 9-8 record this year, which isn't too bad.
Yeah, he's, especially in the last game, which was the first one this week against Ontario, they won 2-1 in overtime, and he was quite solid throughout.
He made 36 saves in that game, and interesting, noted by the Calgary Sun, he notched his 56th career victory for the Flames Farm Club, tying Dwayne Roloson for 7th in the history. Who do you think is the all-time leader in career victories for the Flames Farm team?
Probably a guy that stayed for a while, so I would go with Leland Irving.
You got it. Leland Irving is the all-time leader with 93. So that's probably not it. I mean, there's a lot of good records to have, but that's not one you want to have. You want to be called up to the NHL. So, you know, you don't want to be down there playing that many wins.
Yeah. Well, I wonder if Curtis McIlhenny is probably up there in second or third. Because the Flames, I know before, they used to cycle through goalies left, right, and center. So
yeah, I could also see a guy like Kevin Lalonde being up there because he was here for a while, or Danny Sabourin. He was here when they were in St. John.
Yeah, a guy like Trevoloff.
Trevoloff didn't play much in the NHL, though, did he?
I have no idea. So yeah.
We'll see if we can get that list for next week. And there are some interesting quotes I'm reading here from a recent article in The Sun. This is an article that was written by Wes Gilbertson, and he actually talked to Scott Guthrow, who's the goaltending coach in Stockton, and when asked about Yanni Ordio, he said that his numbers aren't what we'd like them to be, but we've made some adjustments to his game here in the last little bit. Just some small things to work on, and we've seen a big change. For him, it was a lot of just stop thinking and just play, and then working on the little things like setting his feet before the shot and tracking pucks into his glove. Little details, but good habits that go a long way, end quote. So I'm glad to hear that management thinks that Ordio's coming around, and I don't think he's necessarily going to be looked at as the goalie of the future here, but if he can come around and help this team, maybe he gets another contract.
We'll have to see. Especially in the last 2 months, because if the Flames do move one of their NHL goaltenders, I fully expect Kevin Poulin to be recalled. He's had a 920 save percentage in his last since he returned, so he's been playing really well. So I think that for Ordio to remain, he'd have to have a good last 2 months of the season. You also have to look, the Flames have John Gillies coming back next year after he recovers from his injury, and Mason McDonald is AHL eligible as well. So it could get really crowded in the AHL really quickly. So if you are bringing Ordio back, where is he going to play? Is he going to be the backup in the NHL? If so, what do you do with Kevin Poulin? It makes things a little bit more muddled.
After the deadline, depending on where the Heat are at, if they're in a playoff race, I wouldn't be surprised if they keep Poulin in the AHL to anchor the team. And if they need to bring a guy up, bring Ordio up.
Could work that way as well.
If they're not racing for the playoffs, I don't think they would. I think they just bring Poulin up. But if they do want to make the AHL playoffs, I think Poulin is the better of the two goalies right now. So you keep him down there. Interesting quote from Brad Treliving here. quote, Joni is a bit different. He's played professionally in Europe, and if you look at those goalies that have come from the American League and come to the NHL, there's a big body of work usually where they've had a year or two or three where they've played 50-plus games. He really hasn't had that. What he did last year was excellent, but again, it's a small snapshot. So today, do we look at him differently? Probably not. You've got a bigger body of work to look at, but there's been some inconsistency in his game this year. But again, we aren't on a massive high, and then all of a sudden this year on a massive low. Like you said, maybe looking from the outside or from the media or from a fan's perspective, you're over the moon last year, and now you're thinking, geez, what happened to him? And even you and I have said that. Ours is more of a steady approach, saying, you know what? Yeah, he had a real good stretch last year, but let's keep it in perspective. And it's all the same, and it's the same this year. If he's going through some struggles, let's keep that in perspective as well, end quote. So the GM's kind of looking at him and not, I mean, at least not publicly saying we're giving up on this guy, but there's still development to do. And you're right, if we didn't have the goalie logjam, if we didn't have Gillies and McDonald, I think they would bring Ordeo back at least to play as one of the two goalies in the A. But I think if you've got Gillies, see, and I don't even know if you play Gillies and McDonald down there next year.
Well, I think that one thing that could be is that you would have Gillies be the starter in the A and McDonald the starter in the ECHL. You could also just send McDonald back to juniors and say, have fun. You know,
yeah,
be the best goalie in the
team.
Q and just mop up.
Yeah, because to me, I don't want Gillies and McDonald splitting the time. I'd rather have Gillies the starter and someone like Ordeo as a backup.
Yeah. We'll see. There's plenty of different options available to the Flames. So it'll largely depend on whether Ordeo continues playing well like he has recently or if he goes back to struggling. It largely just depends on how the actual player plays, and you can't tell until you get there.
Yeah, and I think it'll depend how he plays down the stretch, too. I mean, if the team can get into the playoffs and he's a part of that, I definitely think they would look at him. We looked last week at some of the goalies available. It's not like there's a lot of goalies available this year. And I think because of that, Ordeo might be an attractive option for somebody else as well. Is he RFA or UFA?
Okay. RFA. But if the Flames don't bring him back. And it's one of those situations.
We could always retain his rights and he could go
over
Europe.
Well,
too.
It's one of those situations that goalies take a long time to figure it out. And if you're looking objectively from an outsider's perspective, he would probably be one of the top guys that you would want to bring into your organization. Sort of like Anders Nilsson was brought into Edmonton, and he's excelled in the NHL this year. Whether Ordeo would do that and continue on to have success with a new organization, that would be a possibility, not a definite situation.
But even if you look at a guy like our starter of Kari Ramo, I mean, he was with the Montreal organization. He was playing over in Russia at the time. And I believe that Kari Ramo wouldn't be where he was now if it wasn't for those couple seasons of seasoning over in Russia. So maybe you try to do the same thing with Ordeo. You say, we'll retain the rights, we'll send him to play in Europe, and we'll reevaluate him in a couple of years.
And that could very well be what happens. There are plenty of options, and it just depends on what the player wants to do, what the team wants to do, and the actual results at the end of the day. That's why, like, the goalie situation itself, both in Calgary and Stockton, you're not going to be able to solve that now or even in the next 2 months. It won't be until you hit July 1st that things will be a little bit clearer.
Well, Matt, I think that's probably about it for Flames news this week. Before we get to our predictions, just wanted to note for everybody, like him or hate him, Gary Bettman's going to be around for a long time. He just inked a 7-year contract extension with the NHL this week. What are your thoughts?
I don't have a problem with it. I think that it was either too short or too long, his extension. It's set to expire right when the CBA does. And that's not really fair to a replacement person if they're coming in right when there's a lockout. So either his contract should have been for like 8 or 9 years or only like 4. But other than that, he's done a good job in terms of what his actual responsibilities are. Some people hate him, some people like him.
But I can't remember last time there was a loved commissioner in any sport.
No, especially baseball. Or even Roger Goodell.
Part of the job is to be the
bad
guy.
Roger Goodell is pretty much loathed by everybody so in the NFL. So, yeah, that's part of the whole experience is being hated by pretty much everybody.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it becomes part of your... just part of your job as the GM or as the commissioner that you are the bad guy. I mean, you're the guy that has to make the hard decisions and announce the hard decisions. You don't necessarily make them, but you become that face of the league for better or for worse. And I think Gary's taken on the bad guy role well. I mean, you know, even when you see at the draft and the fans boo him as he comes up and he just stands there with a smile on his face and he lets it roll off him very well,
yeah.
I think.
I agree with that. And even when he is presenting the Stanley Cup, he even occasionally will make jokes about it. So
yeah, and at the draft he does too. You know, like he'll just sit there and say, "I'll wait." I remember last year the year before, he approached to announce a trade, and they were booing him, and he's like, "I have a trade you want to hear," and he waited for the fans to shut up. So yeah. I don't know. I think Gary, we can look past him as a personality and what you think there. I think he's done a lot for hockey. I think there's a lot that we don't see that he does. But I think, you know, no matter what commissioner you have, Gary's done a fine job, and I don't see a need to replace him right now. If we had a bunch of teams that had all been moved or shut down, it might be different. But he's managed to keep, minus Phoenix, he's managed to keep a lot of teams that we all thought were going to fail from not failing.
Yeah, and he's been a good ambassador and that for, and his work in keeping Canadian teams viable has to also be commended. If it wasn't for him, I don't think that the Calgary Flames would be a thing, and yeah, we wouldn't be doing this podcast, so have to be appreciative of that.
I think that Gary... Yeah, for sure. And I think that Gary had more influence than a lot of people think in the last two lockouts. I think that Gary really ended up being, from what I've read and what I've heard from people, he was really that peacemaker between the two sides. And he definitely put himself out there as being the bad guy and taking a lot of the brunt of the league's trying to screw the players, whatever. But I think that he was really instrumental in getting what I think are two pretty good CBAs done. You know, the game hasn't changed a lot. We haven't seen the quality, I don't think, really change. If anything, we're in a more interesting era right now with the salary cap and more parity. So,
yeah. Well, like if the NHL didn't have the salary cap, I think the Chicago Blackhawks pretty much would have won like all of
the
Stanley
Rangers
Cups
as well.
From 2010 on. No. You have to look at all the players that Chicago shed after 2010 when they won their first cup. Like, if they had kept guys like Bufflin, Ladd...
But, I mean, the Rangers used to outspend teams 10-1. So, I think that they would still be... I don't think you can look at necessarily what did happen. I think you'd have to look at where the dollars were, and I think that they would have even outspent Chicago for some of those players.
So, the salary cap's the number one reason why the NHL exists in the way that it does. So, that's a huge thing for teams like Calgary... Like, you can imagine if the salary cap wasn't there, how high would our payroll be and how would we be able to compete?
Especially if you look at the Canadian dollar right now, I think you'd see the 6 NHL teams with a for sale sign on them.
Pretty much.
Well, Matt, let's play our weekly predictions game. You ready to go?
One thing I have to say beforehand is that I have to make fun of Edmonton.
All right.
And... Connor McDavid is coming back soon, and apparently tomorrow they will be actually televising the morning skate in Edmonton on Sportsnet.
Really?
That is pathetic.
The morning skate?
Yes. Because, people McDavid's back. Ooh. So that's pathetic. What
you wonder what sport is getting bumped off TV for the morning skate and if it would get better ratings. It's got to be like sumo wrestling or darts or something. Nobody's going to watch anyways.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
That's pathetic.
Well, is it only a regional broadcast or is it a national broadcast?
Sportsnet West, Sportsnet 360.
Wow. Okay. Crazy.
10:30 in the morning. So, yeah, that's bad.
I don't think they ever even broadcast a morning skate for Sid the Kid. The next one, as they call them.
Yeah.
Weird.
Yeah. That's just pathetic.
That's crazy. I didn't even hear that. Wow. And you got to wonder how much that's the Oilers' decision versus, you know, Sportsnet's decision. I mean, maybe they're just going for a ratings grab.
Yeah. I think whichever way you cut it, that's pathetic. So
we'll see. I mean, it would be hilarious if they got more watchers for that than an Oilers game.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. I didn't hear that. So we'll see what kind of ratings that brings in. But I don't know why you'd want to watch the morning skate. Like, just wait for the kid to be back in the game.
Yeah. I don't know. I just thought that was pathetic, so thought I'd share.
The weekly predictions game, as always, is brought to you by TickTix. TickTix connects the sea of red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies their sellers so buyers won't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. Download TickTix in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. Get your tickets and enjoy the Flames hockey. It's not great hockey right now, but it's always fun to go to the games. I mean, you're a season ticket holder. You know it's fun to go to the games if you can be there.
Well, anytime you get to watch one of the premier players in the NHL, it's always awesome to go, and he just happens to play for
That's
the Flames.
True.
So Johnny Gaudreau is worth the price of admission just for him. So whether the Flames are doing good or bad, it's always worth
it. And we have
to go.
8 home games this month. So go on TickTix, download the app on your phone, and you know, check out one of the 8 games we have. And 2 of them happen to be this week, Matt. So if we take a look back at last week first, we had 2 games on the docket, 4 total points. I was optimistic. I thought the Flames would walk away with 3. I thought they'd get a point against Dallas and 2 against Nashville. And I hate to say it, you won with 0 points.
Yeah, that's not really winning. I was hoping that, you know, our reverse psychology thing might have worked out once again, but yeah, that was not a good week of hockey.
I mean, how often do you say, I got 0 and I won?
Yeah.
That's not something we usually say in life.
No. Unless you're golfing.
That's true. And that's what the Flames are going to be doing pretty soon, so...
That's not nice.
Well, if they're not in the postseason, they're golfing, right?
True.
We got 3 games, 6 points in the docket this week. On Wednesday, the Calgary Flames are at home against the Carolina Hurricanes. This is a rematch from earlier this month where we had a 5-2 loss. Then on Friday, the first game of a back-to-back, also here at home, the Columbus Blue Jackets visit the Dome. And on Saturday, the second game of a back-to-back, the Flames travel to Vancouver to take on the Canucks. Matt, you're the winner. Why don't you go first?
I'm going to go with 2 whole points, a victory over Columbus.
It's the easy one, Matt. That's the easy one.
Yeah. I think that because both Carolina and Vancouver are in the midst of a playoff push, I think that they're going to be throwing everything they can to get the win. And, yeah, the Flames are still struggling with consistency. And until we see them putting together quality efforts in each period and in each game, it's hard to bet on them to be able to consistently beat teams that are desperate.
I'm going to go for the second time this season, and I haven't done it since the week of November 16th, but I'm going to go with a goose egg. I would like us to get 2 points, but I don't think the Flames are going to make it out of this week with 2 points. I think coming off the All-Star break, they're going to be a bit sluggish. I think they're going to be sluggish against the Hurricanes. I think they're maybe going to be a little bit overconfident going in against Columbus. And Columbus, I think, can, you know, win a 2-1 game against us. And Vancouver, I think, is going to annihilate the Flames.
Wow. That's pathetic.
Says the guy who won last week with zero.
You're trying to steal my thunder. Jeez.
I don't know. I don't think we're going to do it.
Yeah.
We're not seeing the Flames play well against bottom teams.
No. Well, we're not really seeing the Flames play well, period. So
that's true.
So, yeah,
and like you said, until they can put together 60 minutes of hockey, I can't really bet on them to win.
No. We all wish that they were playing better, but if the Flames are wanting to get back into the playoff picture this month, they're going to need to win at least 10 of the 13 games, and especially with who they're playing, yeah, that's going to be a very tall order.
And if we look even past this week, I mean, next week we have the Toronto Maple Leafs coming to town. Then we have another back-to-back against San Jose and Phoenix. The week after that, we have three home games. We have the Ducks coming to town for a matinee on Monday the 15th. We have a later game against the Minnesota Wild, and the Canucks are at home. We play the Ducks on the road. We know we're not going to win that one. Might as well write off right now if we're in the Honda Center. We go to L.A. on the road. We have the Islanders come here, the Senators come here, and then we play the Flyers. So it's going to be a tough month.
That's why January was the most important month of the season, because they were playing mostly so-so teams, and they went 4-6-1 when they needed to win 8 or 9 of those games. So it is what it is.
It's really weird that December they played so well. They didn't do it leading up to it, and they haven't done it afterwards, but something just sparked in December.
Well, even in the 7-game winning streak, they didn't particularly play well.
They were putting together 60 minutes of hockey on most nights.
True. It's just frustrating to see, because you know that this team is better in terms of talent than what they've shown, but they're just not putting the pieces together right now.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see how it goes this week, but I'm not all that confident.
Oh. Hopefully they outperform both what we've been predicting, and we're coming in a more positive mode next week.
We've said it a few times in the past, but I'm thinking more so than ever before, we're going to see a deal done soon. I think the Flames are going to want to get a jump on the deadline on the 29th, and I wouldn't be surprised if next week or even the week after we've got something to talk about.
Yeah.
Like, I think teams now know if they're buyers or sellers, which we've been waiting for. And especially a team like Calgary now knows. I think we can all say we're sellers.
Yeah. And Calgary does have, like, 8 or 9 pieces that they could potentially move out.
But, I mean, if you look at December, we thought maybe we'd be buyers. Now I think we're firmly in the seller camp, so let's just sell. And if we can get a deal done early and get a better price, let's do it.
Yeah. Well, if you look at back when the Flames failed to move Camilleri at the deadline, I think the Flames are more likely to want to get stuff done early instead of waiting for the rest of the market to sort itself out.
Yeah, no, for sure. And I think that you're right about the Camilleri thing, that we need to do it. We can't let somebody walk because we're waiting. And I mean, the Camilleri thing, as Burke explained it to us, was that we were waiting in a queue. There was guys that had to go before him, and that's why I didn't end up going. So to me, beat the queue, be first, and get your deal done. You know, don't let the Flames wait on anybody else. Because I don't want to be sitting there on the 29th saying, okay, who can we move? Oh, we got to wait for these four other guys to move. Oh, darn it, we didn't get so-and-so moved, like with Cammy. Move.
Yeah, well, especially this year with the Flames having like 8 or 9 players that they could potentially move, it's not viable to do that all in one day. If you're intending on moving out, say, 4 or 5 of those players, it's just not realistic to do that all in one day. So that's just too many pots going at the same time. You have to get some of the work done beforehand.
Yeah, for sure. And I think that if you can get a jump on, I mean, every year we see one or two deals done in the weeks leading up to the deadline. We've already seen some big deals done, but every year we see one or two deals done leading up to the deadline that really establish deadline pricing. you know, they're done the week before, 2 weeks before. And I think the Flames could be that team this year that says, we're done. Our big pieces are moved. And we've now established what a, you know, a top four defenseman goes for, or a top six forward, that sort of thing.
Well, even if you look at the other four teams that are below us in the standings, the five teams in total, those are pretty much the only guys that are selling. Edmonton only has two or three pieces that they're going to be able to move. Toronto, maybe three, maybe four. Buffalo has, I think, one, maybe two pieces that they're going to move. And outside of Scott Hartnell, I don't think Columbus has anything that they're going to move. So, in terms of just raw pieces that you could actually trade for, Calgary's one of the few teams that is a one-stop shop. Everybody else is too close to a playoff spot, at least at this point, to define them as legitimate sellers right now.
I also think that we might, if we can get a deal done earlier, we might see the Flames be able to get a better deal from a team that's pushing for a playoff spot instead of trading with someone already in. I mean, the league is so close this year that I think you might get a team who's, you know, pushing for a spot, somebody like, you know, maybe New Jersey or Carolina, or in the West, maybe somebody like Minnesota or even Anaheim, who says we
or just Vancouver
need that.
Or Arizona, even.
Yeah, that's true. But I think someone who goes, you know, okay, we're just put, or even Nashville, who's saying we just need to keep our head above water, and we need that piece from you now to do that.
Mm-hmm. That's why I could see Hudler specifically fetching quite a bit big price, because there's several teams that are that should be playoff caliber teams that just need that little bit of extra offense, and Hudler probably would be the cheapest option of potential rentals.
Yeah, no, I think you can be right there, and we've talked about that for a while. I think Hudler's going, I think Russell's going, and we'll talk more about that as we get close to the deadline.
Yeah, well, I think Dallas is probably the likeliest destination for Hudler just because they're weak on the right side. But that's another day, another conversation.
For sure. Well, Matt, let's perhaps have that conversation next week. And you have a good week. Enjoy the three games. And I will talk to you next Monday.
Yeah, take it easy. Thanks for listening, everybody.
Have a good one.
Bye.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.